The first line of Stevens's last poem draws a great deal of attention from his readers, especially perhaps among philosophers, seemingly unassuming. Once again, we see that trope, as American philosophy can tend to be unassuming, that in its unassuming quality, it assumes that there's nothing required of the reader to grasp the meaning of the poem at the end of the mind. Beyond the last thought rises in the bronze decor. A gold feathered bird sings in the poem without human meaning, without human feeling, a foreign song. If the bronze decor could surprise, even with the reference, we heard it before in the last lecture, to coppery keen claws, let's not forget Stevens's blind parakeet of parakeets. As his pure intellect applies its laws, he moves not on his coppery keen claws. He munches a dry shell while he exerts his will. It never ceases, perfect cock, to flare in the sun pallor of his rock. The bird is blind. He does not move. This is the reason why parakeet of parakeets, you see that. He is not paradise of parakeets, of his gold ether, golden alguacil, except because he broods there and is still. To get to this last poem, one we just cited, of mere being, it would take a Helen Ventler, a Harold Bloom, the best names. I've just counted off Harvard and Yale to tell us the poet's meaning in the background, and lesser readers can fall silent. One of Stevens's philosophical admirers was Richard Cobb Stevens. I say this, all of these sections and the whole of this paper was conceived in his memory. And I'm coming to the last section of an entire essay written in his honor, as Richard tended, this is the question of silence, to be stunned when it came to Wallace Stevens' color language, coppery keen claws, gold ether, golden alguacil, bronze decor. In the figure of the youth, as virile poet, which we've been reading, we even get a color allusion to an Irish Jesuit of sprung rhythm, reminding us that he tracked the language through all its color falls, citing Hopkins' poem to Henry Purcell and his own veritable ether, Hopkins, heir of angels. As Stevens quotes the beginning of the last quatrain, the thunder purple, sea beach plumed, purple of thunder. Not only Stevens' poetry, but in philosophy too, its color, in this case the yellow, the amount of it, that is the only thing Maurice Merleau-Ponty needs to explain space and time. Elsewhere, I've written on Merleau-Ponty and affect and color with respect to space, its perception, its requirement of all sense. As Merleau-Ponty suggests, who did not stop there, repeating the same reference, the same image again and again, that's the working method of phenomenology, variation in the French mode. And so Merleau-Ponty quotes Jean-Paul Sartre, who wrote of nothing more than yellow, the same yellow that stunned the then Jesuit Richard Stevens, turning over the image in his mind. That yellow rent in the sky over Golgotha is an anguish-made thing, an anguish which has turned into a yellow rent in the sky, and which is immediately submerged and thickened by the qualities appropriate to things. And that's Merleau-Ponty citing Sartre. Merleau-Ponty, who goes on to explain after citing this quote from Sartre, the philosopher always in dialogue, as French philosophers of the continental style tend to be in dialogue with others, in this case with Malraux, who in turn speaks of Renoir on the question of color, as Malraux writes, now as Merleau-Ponty continues to take over his words, which was less a way of looking at the sea than the secret elaboration of a world to which that depth of blue, whose immensity he was recapturing, pertained. As Merleau-Ponty proceeds to quote Paul Valéry in saying the painter takes his body with him, this is a way of conveying what Merleau-Ponty just a little later will call, note the distinction, set off in quotes, we see it here, the other side of looking. This other side will be all the sides of perception, as Merleau-Ponty writes in the Phenomenology of Perception, inasmuch as we also, very important to emphasize, also see the depth, speed, softness, and hardness of objects, Cézanne says, we even see their odor. Merleau-Ponty repeats the reference to Cézanne again and again, quite as Nietzsche also connects knowledge, sensio, and sapio, the last for Nietzsche, including both taste and smell. It's because Merleau-Ponty also cites Cézanne with respect to the painter's own preoccupation, the painter Cézanne's preoccupation with science as such, as Patrick Aidan Heelan likewise emphasizes with respect to Cézanne that, and Heelan also talks about the same moment too, the Cézanne painting. Color is the place where our brain and the universe meet. How is color the place? We think of Stevens' bronze découpe, a color substantive, like Stevens's coppery keen claws. Merleau-Ponty goes on to write almost in Stevensian terms, there is no one master key of the visible. One needs for Merleau-Ponty to break up the form spectacle for the sake of color. Thus, the portrait of Valéry, we see that here, sets white spaces, a being more general than the yellow being or green being or blue being. That's the quote. Randall Jarrell reads Heidegger, not Merleau-Ponty, to read his Stevens. This, when Jarrell is writing for between Stevens and Jarrell himself, was a time, as Alastair MacIntyre, that's his, the new version of the book, memorializes the period in After Virtue in which G.E. Moore is as thunderous as Einstein. That's when we think of Stevens between college and his time working in New York. A thunder which opens, as MacIntyre has it, a new heaven. And if we now hear Stevens, now we're going to quote, it was nowhere else. It was there, and because it was nowhere else, its place had to be supposed, itself had to be supposed, a thing supposed, in a place supposed, a thing that reached, in a place that reached. Jarrell cites this to jar the well-intentioned reader by reminding the reader, not of some, but all, of Stevens' poetry's tendency to tedium. This rhymes, no accident intended, with harmonium, thus to emphasize that this is, as Jarrell writes, G.E. Moore at the spinet. Right enough. As I also just quoted, at least in the last video, Stevens is Peter Quince at the clavier, all allusion, as I noted then, to Herrick's Julia. Poets do that. Just as my fingers on these keys make music, so the self-same sounds on my spirit make a music too. The lines mark out the differences between male and female desire. To write about this took an entire book for me, The Hallelujah Effect, for Stevens percolating a few lines. Thinking of your blue shadowed silk is music. It is like the strain waked in the elders by Susanna. Whose strain? Which elders? Stevens doesn't tell us, he doesn't need to. She walked upon the grass, still quavering. And we read on, just a little more. We knew that it was coming. Anon, the lamp's uplifted flame reveals Susanna and her shame. Her shame. Of course it was. The poem that captures the philosopher today as it captures Critchley, who also writes, titling his book with the same lines, Mereness. that he also used to write about Levinas, pre-Platonic thinking. Shakespeare, too, is the idea of order at Key West. Stevens takes us there in our minds, even those of us who write books like The Hallelujah Effect to unpack the difference that is the difference of desire, male and female. For Stevens, she sang beyond the genius of the sea. We read on to find ourselves confronted with the sea monster. Nietzsche also invokes, along with Aeschylus, to tell us, this is the beginning of the gay science for Nietzsche, of the waves, countless, unquenchable of laughter, ancient laughter, made constant cry, caused constantly a cry that was not ours, although we understood, inhuman, of the veritable ocean. Nietzsche writes, what he calls, referring now to Newton, actio in distans, where he writes about women, it would inspire Derrida. We heard him at the start. It is the theme of Spurs, Nietzsche, but the subject will be woman, says Derrida. But we've already seen at the start, if not what Nietzsche means, certainly what Derrida suggests, as Nietzsche reflects, this pretended better self hides the hiding, petty noise, nota bene, both. The pretended better self and the hiding. Both perspectives are voices of male desire, observed admiration, and minimalizing qualification. As Stevens writes, for she was the maker of the song she sang. The ever hooded, tragic, gestured sea was merely a place by which she walked to sing. Whose spirit is this, we said, because we knew it was the spirit that we sought and knew that we should ask this often as she sang. She is not the key to the poem, The Idea of Order at Key West. This we know, in the same way that the poet can tell us that when she sang, the sea, whatever self it had, became the self that was her song, for she was the maker. She is that dream projected, as Nietzsche writes in the second book of De Gay Science, a spirit-like intermediate being, quietly observing, gliding, floating. It's for the same reason that she, in the Stevens poem, is not, in this case, only she, forever she, at one with the sea, regarded not by Stevens alone, because always mediated by and with another that is not she, the we, that corresponds to the other to whom the poetry speaks. Then we, as we beheld her striding there alone, knew that there never was a world for her except the one she sang and singing made. The address in this case is to one named, or else a name is given that we, the readers, can also share, travelogue of the mind, as this is. We get his full name, Ramon Fernandez. Tell me if you know. Before the poet asks an impossible question of topologies and demarcating lines, why, the glassy lights in the fishing boats at anchor there, as the light descended, tilting in the air, mastered the night and portioned out the sea. Or maybe the named Rameau did know, as we continue to read the poem's stunning conclusion, every line wrought. Of course it's wrought. Every word he, the poet, sang of the unnamed she, the inhuman sea, written to culminate in this verse, these words, oh, blessed rage for order, pale Ramon, the maker's rage to order words of the sea, words of the fragrant portals dimly starred, and of ourselves and of our origins in ghostlier demarcations, keener songs. And that's the next talk, Poetic Virility.